Thank you. Please stand. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, neither height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and beneath are the everlasting.
With faith in Jesus Christ, we received the body of our brother Fosdo for burial. Our brother was washed in holy baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Let us therefore with confidence pray to God our Heavenly Father, the giver of life, that he will raise him to perfection in the company of the saints.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Fosdo. We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth, until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Please sit. We will have the eulogy by Dr. Leo Brewster and Wayne Brewster.
Church, we thank you for taking this time to come to reflect on the person known to most of you as Fuzzy or Mr. Brewster, but to us, he was Daddy. Fuzzy Brewster was born in St. Michael, Barbados on the 17th of February 1935 to Kenneth and Eulalie Brewster. He was the third of six children, Roy, Marjorie, both of whom predeceased him, then Fuzzy, Ken Wall or Robert, who many of you know, Eugene and Oliver, all of whom are here today. He grew up in Rouen Road and had friends from across the Bell Gully and the surrounding neighborhoods. In his formative years, he attended the St. Giles Elementary School, the College of the Ivy, don't mind what's going on today, and Combermere Secondary School. From there, early on, he won a scholarship to Harrison College, where he excelled in the classics. He really loved college. Upon leaving Harrison College in 1955, he was appointed clerk in the Colonial Chief Secretary's office. During this period, he earned an external Bachelor of Arts degree in history from the London University, graduating with second class honors in 1961. After leaving the Colonial Chief Secretary's office, he moved on to the Ministry of Communication and Works, where he worked until 1962. He married Chlorine Holder on August 12, 1962, and had two children, Fuzzy Leo in 1963 and Wayne Martin Milner in 1966. From then onwards, he continued his professional education, just never seemed to stop. He furthered his education in public administration in 1963 and international relations in 1967. He went on to do training in journalism in 1974, and he was also studying at the same time law, where he completed his bar finals in that same year. He was admitted to the bar in 1978. He just loved to keep himself mentally active. In the public service, he branched out into the Foreign Service early, from about 1966, where he was a Foreign Service officer, and then First Secretary in the Barbados High Commission, London in 1968, and Counselor and Head of Chancery in 1973. Many people wouldn't realize, but Daddy enjoyed a good party. He, I remember, used to have some of the best parties when we were in the UK at home. The parties were sweet. It was music that you didn't know because we were six and three, four, and you later realize it turned out to be Calypso from Sparrow, Byron Lee and the Dragonaires, the Escorts, the Merry Men, and a whole heap of others. And ska and reggae used to be licking down the place. We were often told to go to bed, and we would sneak back out and watch the party going on from the top of the stairs. And everyone was enjoying themselves, and whenever a shadow used to pass by going to the kitchen, we would duck down. And we would only have to eventually be caught up by Daddy, and then he would put us to bed again. Daddy became a counselor in charge of affairs to the embassy in Barbados, the embassy of Barbados in the USA from 1972 until 76. And transitioning into a new environment from what we knew as the UK was not easy, but Daddy has a way of making things, especially change, easy. The USA was totally different to the UK, and the threats were a lot more real and noticeable in the early 70s. Really noticeable. Daddy was a disciplinarian, and that's when it took effect in a major way at that time. You couldn't lean too far left or right. Because if you did, the rule of law was applied, and Daddy was the hanging judge and the executioner. His siblings also recalled that when they were growing up, Daddy was also responsible for their well-being and upbringing. And he always tried to remind them to honor the Brewster name, study hard to make education work to uplift themselves. He always made sure that they went to church and showed respect to others. He was also responsible for their discipline, so I know he had good prayer practice when it came to Wayland. After being reposted to Barbados, he served as permanent secretary in the Ministries of Agriculture from 78 to 83, Education from 83 to 86, Foreign Affairs from 86 to 91, Labor from 91 to 93, Environment from 93 to 94, then the Prime Minister's Office, and finally functioning as head of civil service from 94 to 95. And then he was appointed advisor on public sector reform, in which post he served until 1996 when he retired. Daddy always enjoyed being a permanent secretary. He often said that administration was pretty much the same wherever you go, but it's getting to know the ministry and the functions of the ministry and how it works that is important, and then how to make it work better is where the challenge lay. In recognition of his public service feats, he was made a commander of the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire in 2003. In his other activities, he was past member and chairman of the Caribbean Broadcasting Corporation, past member of the Freemasons Association, a life member of the Barbados Cricket Association, a member of the Bar Association, a member of the Royal Commonwealth Society, and a past committee member of the Old Harrisonian Society. He kept himself active. He enjoyed his hobbies, which were reading, cricket, horse racing, football, and traveling. When it came to his grandchildren, he was something else. I was recently reminded by Auntie Mavis, his sister-in-law, that grandparents' money and parents' money are not the same. And never shall they meet. And this was also true with Daddy. He was an exceptional granddad who loved his grandchildren with a fierce pride and adoration. No matter how busy he was, he stopped what he was doing to listen and attend to them. He would reschedule his work to ensure that they could attend school events and sporting activities and cultural and extracurricular activities. He would collect them from school when Amory and I were not available, and all he ever used to say was, "How can I assist?" He never missed primary school or secondary school sports day once they were competing, and the same applied to NAMSAC and BSAC once they were competing. Now, the interesting thing is that he loved St. Cyprian Sports Days down in the Pine Basin. And I remember his first half day when he turned up after a lot of the events had taken place. It was around 1 o'clock. And he asked how things were going. And the boys asked him, "Why weren't you here before the CS run?" But the cricket ball throws, the relays, and the tug of war were still to come. And they were members of Blue House, and Daddy went down to Blue House to talk to Miss Toppin, who was the house lead then. And he didn't leave there until sports was over. He encouraged all the children to compete in the open races so that they could get points for their house. But the next year, Daddy was wearing blue from the beginning, and he was there from the time they had the march on. And he never missed sports day, and Auntie Eugene was always there loving every minute. He loved to see them play sports, taekwondo, road tennis, cricket, football, but he really enjoyed them when they played water polo and traveled with them to 2 Carifta water polo competitions when they were respective age group team captains, and they won their medals on both occasions. He taught them to fly kites and repair kites. And I remember the first year that Daddy taught Anish and Fossil how to fly a kite. Anish couldn't hold the ball. He was only about 5 then, and Fossil was about 3. And Daddy held the ball and let Anish work the string after he showed him what to do. And Fossil was just running around, and he was the fastest kite upper I had ever seen. Go on, get the kite, come down, go on, back up and flying, you know. The following year, Daddy started to do tricks with kites, and they loved it. Because by then, I had to make sure that he had his own kite, that he enjoyed kite flying. He never missed an Independence Day parade or Gold Cup Day at the garrison with them when they were young. And when Amory asked if he could manage when they were both heavy, because by then they were getting heavy. They're not heavy, they're mine. That's all he would ever say. And they would be gone for most of the day or most of the evening if it was Gold Cup, just out having fun with Granddad. He would never miss an Independence Day parade when they were cadets on parade. And he was really proud to see them taking part in that national event in their Sea Scout ceremonial uniforms.
Good afternoon. The Lord is merciful. As many of you know, this is one of Daddy's favorite greetings. I'll say that there comes a time when the loved one must transition to the next level. This is never wanted or expected. But you also have to stop and think about the brevity of life and who you are, what you do, and what you can bring and help people with. Daddy lived a vivid, exuberant, opportunity-filled, humble, and participatory life. He played an active role in several aspects of the transformation of Barbados during his public life as a civil servant. He was a family man who looked out for his siblings and extended family. He loved doing charitable deeds and helping persons at all levels. Daddy always had a way to put himself as a cut above the rest and led by example. He was a loving dad. As a parent, Daddy was firm, but a very fair disciplinarian. He firmly believed in excellence, decorum, composure, calmness, and peace. Daddy always exemplified excellence in what he was doing, and he fully expected it from me and Leo. He pushed us to excel in all we did. Daddy was very passionate about our education. He made sure when we came back from the US, I was fully prepared for the 11 plus, weekly taking me for extra classes to pass 11 plus. During that preparation, one day Daddy looked at me and said, "You know, you better pass for Harrison College. I am not driving you up to St. John or Waterford every morning, so you better get your grades straight, you know." Daddy was an avid reader. He instilled in me a love for reading of books also. When I was younger, he would take me to the library every week, every weekend, to choose two books. I had to complete reading those two books or three books by the end of the week. You know, he always reminded us when we were growing up in England and in the States, no matter where you go, you are a representative of and for Barbados, and never disgrace your family name. Daddy taught me how to play football one time, and showing me to play soccer, football. You know, he's teaching me how to position your foot and everything, and how to make the kicks. All that while he was shouting out, "Pelé, Pelé, Pelé." And I looked at him and I said one day, "Who is Pelé?" I was 5, so I said, who is Pelé? Daddy looked at me and said, "He is the greatest football player in the world. You should aspire to be like him." Needless to say, in my heart, Daddy was Pelé for many, many years. Daddy always said he had a heart of an athlete. That's why he would never put on weight, you know. Daddy set high academic standards for both of us. And when my grades fell below a B, the lashes would flow to bring me back onto the correct path, you know. When I had my two accidents, it was Mom and Daddy who worked tirelessly to get me back on the level that I am and made it better. Daddy took me overseas to ensure I could get the level of convalescent care in Canada, and Auntie Norma was his guardian who took me through everything. Throughout my pain and physiotherapy, he kept me there, kept me pushing forward. Every day, you have to set a target to move further than you did yesterday. Push through the pain. Use it to drive yourself forward always. And at the end of the session, when I was totally drained, he looked at me and said, "Get some rest. We go again tomorrow. And you will do it." You know? Daddy was a man of quiet demeanor with a loving heart, but he had the roar of 10 lions when he was fully provoked. He had a smile that would light up the room, and his calm, jovial laugh could make people want to be with him or near him. He never stopped encouraging me to do more and improve myself. When I graduated from my master's, my family came up. Daddy pulled me to the side one day and said, quietly and said, "You've reached this level. You can do more. Go for it." You know? He encouraged me in a vibrant social life, but never to neglect my responsibilities and duties. Often he would tell me, "You can go out and party on Friday night to whatever time you want to do. Just remember, Saturday morning, you're cutting the grass at 7 a.m. That's your job. Or on Sundays, if I go on Saturday night, he would say, "That's all good. Stay out as long as you want. Remember, church is in the morning." He was always calm, always giving me advice. He always found a way to give me the bigger picture. That I really will miss, and I have always cherished. As an adult, I know Daddy as a friend, a man that was never able to be stumped in giving direction and advice. While I was in Texas studying, I became drawn into a lawsuit. I explained to him what was taking place. He calmly listened to me and told me, "I'll get back to you." The next day, he gave me the advice that provided a way to extricate myself from all the proceedings. There was never a problem too big for Daddy to provide me with some solutions and guidance. Daddy was truly a rock in my life. He was a leader of all men, a leader of many men, and an inspiration to me. He'll be forever missed and ever loved. I love you, Daddy. I'll miss you.
We'll be back for that soon, but there's just so much, honestly. On his Masonic side, Worshipful Brother Brewster was initiated into Freemasonry at Union Lodge in 1966. He then became the Master of Union Lodge in 1998 and was appointed Assistant District Grand Master for Barbados and Eastern Caribbean from 1994 until 2004, one of the longest stints to my knowledge. In the Scottish Constitution, he held the rank of past Senior Grand Warden, and he was a member and senior functionary of numerous higher orders, including the Barbados Rose Croix, the Royal Order of Scotland, and the Royal and Select Masters. He was a founding member of several Masonic higher orders. Daddy enjoyed Masonry. He was also an active participant and contributed to the construction of the Masonic Lodge Temple at Salters in St. George, and he loved attending district communications held across the region. For him, Masonry was universal, and it was a chance to catch up with regional friends and make new ones all on the same level. In conclusion, his family wishes to thank you. All his family wishes to thank you for the time you've taken to attend this service, both in person and online, locally and overseas. And we extend our deepest gratitude to you and to all the persons who became his close friends in his last few years. To his nurses and the doctors who enjoyed his company and the jokes he cracked with them. Because, you know, when Daddy started to feel ill and we were taking him to the doctor, He used to look at us and say, I'm not a pincushion. Why do you keep prodding me? He has touched the hearts of many, and many of you in ways that can be reflected or captured. But your presence here today lets us recognize the true contribution he has made. One of the things that he always lived for and stood for was this simple phrase, and he drilled it in us from the time we were young. The height of great men reached and kept was not attained by sudden flight, but they, while their companions slept, kept toiling upwards through the night. He will be missed. We love you, Daddy. In Dio Fides. Thank you.
We will have a solo in the garden by Johan Haynes.
I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry near, none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we turn, be there, none other has ever known. I'd stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. calling, then he walks with me and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. And the joy none other has ever known.
Thank you.
Please stand as we sing the hymn, And Can It Be?
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant Fazlo, and we pray that having opened to him the gates of larger life, you will receive him more and more into your joyful service, that with all who have served you in the past, he may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Please sit for the first Bible reading.
Sorry, good afternoon. I read it for the Word of God, taken from Proverbs chapter 3, reading from verse 1 to 14. My son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in your heart, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you peace and prosperity. Let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. Then you will win favor and a good name in the sight of God and man. Trust in the Lord before your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your path straight. Do not be wise with your own eyes. Fear the Lord and shun evil.
This will bring health to your body and nourishment to your bones. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing and your fats will brim over the new wine with wine. My son, do not displace the Lord's discipline and do not resent his rebuke. Because the Lord disciplines those who he loves. As a father, the son he delights in. Blessed are those who find wisdom, those who gain understanding. For she is more profitable than silver, and he is better returns than gold. This is the word of the Lord.
Congregation, remain seated as the choir chants Psalm 46.
Oh, hey, Lord, oh, that's right.
sit as we have the second Bible reading by Robert Brewster.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake, we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in this creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we sing the hymn before the address, through all the changing scenes of life.
Thank you.
name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please sit. Separation. That is not a word we like to hear. It is a mournful word, and it is a frightening word. Separation is the first step in ending a marriage. Separation is the dread of every mother taking a small child into a crowd. Separation is the heart of loneliness. Separation is the worst punishment that can be meted out to an inmate in prison. The isolation cell is dreaded, for it means separation from all that is familiar and all human contact. And I venture to suggest this afternoon that separation is also the source of our greatest grief. As we gather in this funeral service to say farewell to someone who was dear to us. But you and I have gathered here this afternoon to give God thanks for the life and for the witness of Fosno Brewster. We are gathered to grieve at his death, for the reality is now that you and I must face life separated from him. You and I in time will leave his mortal remains in the cemetery, and we will journey on in life without his physical presence. And I want to suggest that these words from the Apostle Paul are radical and ought to be refreshing as we hear the Apostle Paul speaking to the Christians in Rome. He says, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Neither life nor death, nor angels, nor principalities, nor any other thing. The blessing in Fosno's death is that through God in Christ, there is no tragic separation, that there really is no separation here for us this afternoon. For even though he has gone from our presence, he is very much present with Almighty God. What we think of as an ending is really a beginning for him. Nothing separated Fosno from the love of his family and his friends. As human beings, when we are coming to the closing of our days in this life, in those times when you and I struggle with the weaknesses created by our illness, in those days, in our frailty as human beings, we can sometimes feel that we are alone. And at such times like those, it is never easy for any one of us to bear. But as human beings, we need each other, especially in our times of greatest need. And I am sure that in those times when Fosno was at his lowest ebb, he must have found comfort in the knowledge and the love and the care of those who were there to support him. Those who came and took on responsibility to offer him comfort and solace in his times of pain and suffering. And therefore, in his dying, nothing separated him from the love of others. In his death also, nothing separated him from experiencing death as a normal part of a person's natural existence, as a transition from one state of being to another state of being. Fosno worshipped in this church before I ever came here. And during that period of time, he would have come to the realization that his faith in God brought him benefits which would last beyond the grave. And in his own way, as he made his journey on this Christian pilgrimage, he would at times be able to speak freely of his faith in God and acknowledge that death as the next phase in the journey to eternal life. In his own faith journey, he would have recognized death as a part of the journey of life. Death, whenever it comes, whether it comes at an early age or whether it comes in old age, it always seems tragic to us. But I want to suggest to you this afternoon that we must never see death as evil, because of God in Christ's example of rebirth, because of God's promise of new life to us who have our place, our trust, and our faith in Him, you and I as Christians can face our own death with a calmness and confidence that others find hard to understand. I am persuaded that our brother Foslow departed this life knowing that peace and tranquility, and therefore nothing separated him from the naturalness of going from life in this world to life in the nearer presence of God. But if there is any sense of separation in Foslow's death, it is in the loss that we might feel this afternoon. We feel the separation from him, and so we may cry, and we will talk at length of memories of him, and both the tears and the memories are important and they are needed, but we do so not grieving as those who have no hope, for in a real sense, even now with all that we are feeling, we are not totally separated from him. We have this promise of the Apostle Paul that our time apart will not be permanent, that there is a place in which there will be a reunion with those whom we love, a place which we are told we will no longer have pain, a place we are told there will no longer be crying and no longer be suffering. But until then, you and I are not totally separated from Foslow, for each of you who knew him and loved him carry him with you in your hearts and in your minds. You are stamped by his influence. His image is in you. He lives on in you in the values you shared with him and the memories that you made together with him. Like a good piano concerto by Chopin that lives on long after the composer has died, Foslow's smile and warmth, Foslow's bounty and generosity, his wit and his charm will live on in each one of you, for they have helped to shape who you are. And therefore, in the days ahead, that gulf of the seeming separation will cease to seem as great. But most of all, in his death, Foslow knew no separation from God's love. There, the words of the Apostle Paul seem most true. I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ, O Lord. Yes, we heard these words in the reading this afternoon, but I think it is important for us to hear them again, because you see, it is the love of that God gives us and not this life itself that we live that is the real treasure that God has given to us. And we hold this treasure in our bodily vessels given to us by Almighty God. We hold this great treasure of God's love in these fragile human bodies. But my friends, even though our vessels become bruised and battered, even though our vessels become broken through life's pilgrimage, even though our bodies grow weak and we deteriorate over time, we still have this treasure of love given to us by God's self. With the God who made everything, that great architect of the universe, that wonderful creator God who made us as the crowning touch of his creation, would that God allow death to wipe it all out in a single stroke? I do not believe that to be the case. My friends, death may be the greatest threat any of us must face. As the Apostle Paul says, it is the last great enemy. But my friends, death is a defeated enemy. Death has been conquered. Death holds no more dominion over us, but the love of God goes on to the grave and beyond the grave. And that is why the prophet Isaiah could promise that God will swallow up death in victory. And the Apostle Paul could claim in builder's language, if our earthly house were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Both of these men of God knew death is not a separation from life, but they knew death as a triumphant promotion to a richer life. And so today, let us pause, each of us in our own way, and give God thanks that God's victory on the cross bridges all the separations in life and leads eventually to eternal life. Let us pause and give God thanks for sharing God's love with us through God's children, children like Foslo, children like you, and children like me. And let us look forward with longing to that day when all separations are ended. And you and I are one in our Father's house, wherever we conceive that Father's house to be. For those of you who mourn and grieve the death of our brother, take heart in the knowledge that this separation is not the end of the story, as some may think. As I said recently, there is an epilogue to this story. Let us pray that Foslo may rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen.
The choir will now render an anthem. Please stand as we recite the Apostles' Creed as found on page 6 in your leaflet.
I believe in God,
the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in
Jesus Christ, Holy Son of God, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
prayers of the people. We pray for those who mourn. We commemorate the departed. Let us pray with confidence to God our Heavenly Father, who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead for the salvation of all. Grant, Lord, that your servant may know the fullness of life which you have promised to those who love you. Lord, in your mercy. Be close to those who mourn. Increase their faith in your undying love. Lord, in your mercy. May we be strengthened in our faith. Live the rest of our lives in fellowship with your Son, and be ready when you call us to the fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy. Show your mercy to the dying, strengthen them with hope, and fill them with the peace and joy of your presence. Lord, in your mercy. We commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice at the faithful witness of your saints in every age, praying that we may share with them in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Please remain standing for the commendation. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. Where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of humankind. And we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to the earth shall we return. For so did you ordain when you created us, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our sound. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints, where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Our Father, who art in heaven, let us commend our brother Foslo to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Deliver your servant Foslo, sovereign Lord Christ, from all evil, and set him free from every bond, that he may rest with all your saints in the eternal habitations, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Foslo. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, in the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. On behalf of the parish family here at St. Barnabas, we want to extend our deepest condolences to you who mourn the loss and passing of our brother Foslo. I also bring you condolences from the Reverend Dr. Marcus Lashley, who cannot be here, and Dean Emeritus, the very Reverend Harold Critchlow and Mrs. Critchlow, and also from the Reverend Father Mark Harewood, who could not be here. We want to assure you of our continued prayerful support as you go through this period of mourning in your lives. During the singing of the next hymn, a collection will be taken that will go towards the organ fund in memory of our brother Foslo.
The hymn, How Great Thou Art. Masonic closing ode. Congregation, please stand for the Nunc Dimittis.
Righteousness is gloriously risen. giving light to those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death. The Lord will guide our feet into the way of peace. Having taken away the sin of the world, Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name, saying, "Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you. Into paradise may the angels lead you. At your coming, may the martyrs receive you and bring you into the Holy Spirit and city, Jerusalem."
indwelling spirit. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the records of their deeds. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help but you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins?
In sure and certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother Fuzlo, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved son shall come again in judgment, both this our brother Fuzlo and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now find rest and refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have our perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved the spirit of faith and courage, that they may have strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of your great goodness and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Rest eternal, grant unto him, O Lord. May he and all the faithful departed, through the mercies of God, rest in peace.
Amen.
Amen.
Great is thy faithfulness. To God be the glory.
Thank you. the King of love, my shepherd is. It is well with my soul.
It is love.
day thou gavest, Lord, is ended.
Let us pray. The Lord bless him and keep him. The Lord make his face to shine upon him and be gracious unto him. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon him and give him his peace this day and forevermore. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. The Lord is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Lord bless you and keep you, make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face toward you and give you peace. Shine upon you and be gracious to you, Lord.